We join our story once again. Both armies have marched to the faded battleground. What feels like oh so long ago, when our heroes first entered the Ebonwood and laid witness to the struggle between the two bloods of the elves. Now, scattered on both sides, our heroes have an unknowing reunion on the battlefield. Nervek, in your squadron, Luvash and Emery, as you stand on the front lines, you gaze out to the tree line in this circular plains outstretching before you, and you watch as the enemy approaches. Banners of green and gold permeate through the air, while yours of purple, silver are at your back. Risen to the rank of general, you step forward after being briefed upon the strategy. Sterak, you march forward. Cornelius, Chadris, and Mira Lee at your back. You gaze at the enemy line, a wall of red and gold trim shields begins to march forward slowly. The very same shields that you had seen several of the members of the High Elven Scouting Party on that fateful day a week ago. The day that almost took the Moor from you. The day that still might. And you wait, knowing what is to come next. The air stagnates and everything is still. And you hear a voice. For those of you fighting for the High Elves, it has been quite some time since you've heard this voice. Brother! It need not be this way! Surrender! The voice booming across the battlefield. Sterak, you recognize it as Valandroth's voice. Emery, you wait in anticipation for what Siatrian's response will be, but all you hear is a soft laugh. Soon, you, Sterak, turn to face him. And Valsidroth raises his sword. And as he does so, time stops. And in that moment, you see the looks of your fellow soldiers surrounding you. Faces of anticipation, faces of fear, some of them clutching symbols close to their chest, gazing at their palms, some in prayer, as the moment has finally approached. The earth begins to tremble. And you watch slowly as tiny cracks in the earth expand into fissures and stretch across the battlefield. And as it does so, both of the sides begin to march towards one another in combat. Let's roll initiative.
What else first?
2 17s.
I got a 9.
Alex with that 20.
Whew.
Emery?
9.
Alright. So,
this is going to be an interesting conflict here. You watch as both of the lines, the front lines, begin to approach one another, and in a clashing of metals, you begin to hear almost a ballad. A ballad that some of you are very familiar with. The song of steel clashes in the air. Now, this is going to be a little different from a typical combat encounter. Firstly, I know Nervek has a vendetta. What will you lead your squadron to do, Nervek?
We're gonna follow orders. I'm not gonna let my personal vendetta sway me. We're gonna do as planned.
Alrighty. Luvash and Emery, you are in the back lines as the shield, as the spellbreakers march forward and meet the enemy front lines of the shield bearers and begin combat. All of you wielding the bows have been ordered to hold your shot. Now, Luvash and Emery, are you also following orders or are you following Nervek out into the battlefield?
I follow orders.
Luvash? I don't think we're getting audio. I think you're still muted.
My god, I'm dumb. Second time in 20 minutes. Sorry. I'll follow Nervek.
Okay, you march into battle. And the first thing that you notice as you do so is peppered among the wood elves, you see a lot of familiar faces. But more so, what catches you off guard is you smell his smell. The man who was your second. The man who you took with you when you committed your crime. The one who still harbors a hatred in revenge for you. You can smell his scent. He is here on the battlefield.
I would have expected anything else.
You follow orders then, and you collide with the front, your squadron of spellbreakers meets that of shield bearers. So essentially, there are 5 of you on your side, Nervek, and 5 of them on their side, and it's going to be a quick little combat. But before we get into that, Sterarch, Cornelius. Cornelius, what position do you hold? You're supposed to be in the second wave along with Sterarch to follow out behind the shield bearers. What do you do?
I will stay in position, although I don't know how to describe it. I will prepare to cast a spell as we're marching.
Which spell?
Spirit Guardians.
All right. Sterarch, what do you do?
I'm going to go towards the crevice that was made.
The crevices are not too wide yet. They were simply laying the groundwork for them to open. They're almost like wounds that haven't been cut too deep yet in the earth. The moment is not right.
I'll stick by as closely as I can to Cornelius then.
Right then. You watch.
I would like to make a special, like, as we're marching, I'd like to gaze out and take kind of a mental note of where the lines are. And I would like to unleash my spell before we meet.
Alright, and you do so. Are you centering it in the center of the battlefield where it will encompass the most of your allies?
Do you want me to send you the spell info?
I believe it covers an entire area.
The area around me that it affects is within 15 feet, but I can choose an unlimited amount of creatures to be unaffected.
Correct. So where are you centering this 15-foot radius?
It is around me.
Okay.
I can't choose that. I can just choose the creatures that aren't affected, and I want to affect... I want to... The unlimited creatures I want to leave unaffected are...
Your allies.
My allies.
Alright.
But I wanted to activate it before everything got confusing and I couldn't tell who was who.
Easily enough. You watch as he puts his arms out on either side, clutching his weapon in front of him, Sterak, and almost like a ghostly visage of himself, a helmeted figure with two strands of bluish silk flowing from the shoulder blades like wings, rises a spiritual visage that kind of hovers around him. Now then, Nervek, the rules for this combat are slightly different. Instead of directly engaging and going through a normal combat, like something that would happen very quickly, essentially you will command everything that happens around you. So you must think strategically. You have the first move, because Luvash threw really high.
Okay.
So...
And so it's essentially, it's 5 in a line and 5 in a line?
It's 4 in a line on your side, 5 in a line on their side. You have Luvash at your back.
Okay. So, explain how turn order will function.
You will issue a command, and then their squadron leader will issue a command, and it'll go back and forth.
Alright, can I perception check for free at the beginning or no?
Yes. Right, so I just... Certain things that you can do is, like, because of your rank that you've attained in the duration of your stay with the High Elves, you can command other squadrons since you hold higher rank than a normal captain to join your force that are nearby.
Okay. First things first, I want to try and figure out who their commander is.
Easily spottable. He's dressed in different garb.
Okay. I'm going to order Luvash to take a pot shot at him.
Okay, so for the rules of this, you will throw a d20 and then add the number of people in your squadron to the roll. And that'll be against that group's AC.
Okay, so just throw a d20 with nothing on it?
Well, you have 5 in your party, including yourself, so it's a d20 plus 5.
Alright, I'll throw. That is a total of 22.
Alright. Nice nat 17, by the way.
Yeah, no doubt.
And the way that it's going to work on my end is I'm going to roll against you, and it's essentially higher number. And depending on how you phrase how you want to go about it, like saying that you want Luvash to attack a specific target, will change the AC that you're trying to beat.
Okay.
So play to your strengths. Yeah, Luvash, you hear Nervek call out, and he points out a target. You knock an arrow into... Actually, point of order, do you take one of the bows that they were going to give you to attune to, or do you hold on to your personal one? It will offer no difference. It's just a stylistic change because your bow functions with the same magical properties as theirs.
Yeah, no. No, I'll just keep mine.
So you knock an arrow into your bow, and with expert precision, fire it off, and it embeds itself in the neck of their commander, who just immediately drops to the ground and scatters their group. You can push forward or continue to fight.
Their group, you said they completely scatter, they run?
They scatter and join different groups around you, as their commander is now lying dead.
Okay, what exactly am I looking at?
You're looking now at another wave of shield bearers followed by swordsmen of all different kinds marching forward, and you know that at your back are all of the rune blades that are about to enter into the fight as well.
Okay. And so right now there's just a little bit of a gap where that group was?
Yes.
Yeah, we'll fill the gap. We'll move up.
All right, so you march forward and meet the next force, which is a a line of four in the front and a line of four in the back.
Mm-hmm.
You have the first move again.
And how many of the spell blades are at our back? Or rune blades, excuse me?
You got three at your back as well, for a total of eight to eight.
All right. Well, do I have to roll initiative? You said I have the first move again?
Yes, you do.
Oh, heck.
That natty 20 mm-hmm. really helped.
No doubt. Is there no distinct leader in this group?
No, there's not.
Okay, then I will just engage as, you know, just sort of like clash. You get me?
Yeah.
Smack into him and...
And
go for it.
If you recall, you can also have your spell blades activate specific things on themselves. You can ask Luvash to shoot some of his magical arrows. Ready your spell breakers to counter spells and whatnot as your actions for your group commands.
Okay. Luvash, so, do you have any like area of effect type of things?
I have one.
You're the one who uses them. Do you think it would be good in this situation?
How many of them are there?
There are eight.
I would say there are eight within a 20-foot radius.
I actually don't remember the exact radius of my...
That's okay. It's okay. I think... Let's see.
Minus 10 feet.
Okay, we'll wait on that. We're just gonna engage like we regularly would. No one dropping anything just yet. Just okay. For the most part, mundane combat.
Roll plus 8.
Roll plus 8, okay.
I got a natural...
Nat 20.
I got a natural 2.
I got a natural 20.
You watch as your spellbreakers march up, form a wall with their shields that interlock together, and then the spellblades behind you just dance with incredible alacrity and slice through their backline and then eviscerate their front.
Feels good, man.
Now, on the other side, Starark and Cornelius, you are the next line to approach forward, and you can see with unerring perception... Nervek, leading his own squadron, with Luvash behind him, cutting through your ranks. Now then, those archers are being ordered to pull. And Nervek, you hear, in the back of your mind, a voice from only one time that you've heard before. Spellbreakers! Raise your shields, arrows are coming. It's the voice of the commander.
Well, you better believe we're gonna do it.
And you watch as every single spellbreaker on the battlefield raises their shield above them, and a dome of metal expands around each and every single spellbreaker. Alright, I'm going to roll a few deck saves as you watch about 4,000 arrows fly at the same time and the sun that was shining sort of low in the sky as it's just past dawn is entirely blotted out. A majority of the Wood Elven side is able to bring up their shields, but those who are not with shields were not so lucky. And you watch Sterark and Cornelius as the arrows descend from the sky and pepper the battlefield. Hundreds fall. Nobody stops. The combat ensues and continues. And you are now ordered to march forward. Emery. You hear Siatrian's voice. Eradicate them. What spell do you use?
Cloud Kill.
You want to read that out for me?
It's got a casting time of one action, a range of 120 feet. Opponents are verbal somatic, concentration up to 10 minutes. You create a 20-foot radius of poisonous yellow-green fog centered at one point you choose within range. The fog spreads around corners, and it lasts for the duration or until a strong wind disperses the fog, ending the spell. The area is heavily obscured.
Okay, so
When a creature enters the spelled area for the first time, or starts a turn in there, the creature must make a con-saving throw. Creature takes 5d8 poison damage on a failed save or half as much on a successful one. The creatures are affected even if they're holding their breath or don't need to breathe. The fog moves 10 feet away from you at the start of each turn, rolling along the surface of the ground. The vapors, being heavier than air, sink to the lowest level of land, even pouring down openings.
So it has to emanate from you in the beginning?
No, I can place it somewhere within range.
Okay. So you're just going to drop it on the group marching forward?
Yeah.
Okay. And you watch as every other caster fires off a volley of magic missiles that fly through the air. Thousands of them. And as you, Sterark, and Cornelius watch this wave of pinkish energy washing over the battlefield, you hear your king. No. And as you turn to look at him, you watch as he lifts the sword once again and delicately forms an arc in the air, and a wall of stone rises about 100 feet tall and blocks all of the magic missiles, cutting off the high elves from their front line and their back line. And you march forward. Sterark, you are not the commander. Neither are you, Cornelius. So, I will ask you now. You see Nurvec and Luvash. Are you going to follow orders and stay in formation?
I'm going to stay in formation, but as they're getting... Have the enemies gotten within 15 feet, or do we just see them hitting the front line?
You just see them hitting the front line, but now they are cut off by a 100-foot tall, 5-foot-thick wall of stone.
I have not been ordered to attack.
Well, you're marching forward now to attack.
My orders are to hold position and not go out and attack people.
But now you're marching forward in the line of swordsmen, the both of you. I'm just asking because you're being led by a squadron commander. I'm just asking if you stick with them or break off.
I'm going to check back at the crevice once more.
They are weakening. But not quite. Do you stay, or do you break?
I gotta go. I'm gonna run off towards that crevice.
Okay, Cornelius, you watch as Sterarch breaks formation and runs towards one of the nearest cracks in the ground.
Full sprint.
He's heading towards one of the cracks at full sprint?
Yes.
Well, crap. And Mirali and Shadris
Mirali and Shadris are not anywhere near you. They're still in the back lines.
Dang it, Sterarch! I'll go after him.
Okay, you run off. And as you do so, Norvek and Luvash, you see them running across the battlefield, breaking formation from the line, marching forward. You don't know what's going on, and you hear Valsidroth speak once again.
Bring them down.
And you watch as all of the shield bearers and all of the swordsmen at the very front on the wood elven side leap towards the wall and meld with it, leaving all of the high elves out in the open, and a volley of arrows fly towards you. Nervak, I'd like you to roll a d20 plus 6.
All right. That is an 11.
You lose all three of your spell blades. All of them get pinned to the wall, and you actually lose one of your spellbreakers as well.
Quick question.
Go for it.
Did my spell go off?
It did, but you can no longer see where it is because of the wall of stone now.
Should I roll damage for it, or does that not matter?
What's the max damage?
It's 5d8.
Do you want to just overchannel it?
No.
Okay. Go ahead and roll damage to give me a general idea. If you're able to.
And plus, it also continues moving backwards, away from me.
All right.
18.
18?
Yep.
Before the wall went up, you saw it fall over a squadron that was pushing forward, but they pushed through it. And as shouts were going out, they just seemed to sort of avoid it, and then the wall came up. Since it's just slowly moving forward.
Okay.
Your squadron is down 4 members now. You're down to 4. As the arrows came flying forward, 3 of your spellbreakers immediately covered you, the general, the commander of the squadron, Nervek, and brought up the shields, completely forming a wall in front of you. Luvash, you crouching down behind the shield as well. But as you look to your left and right, very, very few of your spellbreakers are left in this line that originally marched forward. A lot of them were eradicated by this. Emery, you hear Siatrian.
Bring down the wall.
What do you cast?
I don't know if I have a spell for this.
Well, the rest of your casters are going to go throw Shatter at it.
I don't have Shatter.
Well, as you're deciding what you're going to cast to assist in this, you watch as they begin to march forward in unison, reach down into their cloaks, pull out a shard of this orangish-black crystal, throw it at the wall, and then thousands of thunderclaps can be heard all at once in a symphonous cacophony of sound and destruction as the wall begins to crumble down.
I'm just going to launch Ray of Frosts at it.
Go for it. You do so, contributing what you can as the wall comes down. At this point, hundreds and hundreds of bodies decorate the battlefield. And as the shields come down, Nervek and Luvash, you see Sterarch looming over one of the chasms in the earth, and he jumps. What do you do?
He jumped over it. I take it he lands it.
Into it.
Jumps into it. What are the rest of the Wood Elven soldiers doing?
Continuing with the battle.
Yeah, we're gonna continue. Obviously noting it, but no time to deal with it.
Okay. You have one action before you get into the conflict again.
How many like small groups of soldiers that are on the High Elven side are near me?
Go ahead and roll a 20 plus 4.
Okay.
You're gonna try and rally.
Nine.
The ranks are broken. There, a lot of them are down. You are able to add 2 spellbreakers to your group.
Okay.
The next wave approaches as the wall crumbled. You are surrounded by a line of shield bearers, and then the line of swordsmen come marching forward and trap you in between. This time, they have the advantage first. A squadron of 4 comes forward towards you, and 4 are behind you for a total of 8. Alright, that is 26. You have to roll above 26. You have 6 in your group. Total?
13.
This joint attack from both the front and the back are enough to cut down both the shield breakers that just got added to your group, and Luvash, you are wounded for half of your health as a sword sinks deeply into your back before you're able to get away. Your action.
And all of them are still surrounding us, yeah?
Yes.
Okay, well, let's see what I've got in the toolbox here. I'm going to move so that way I am at least 5 feet away from all my men.
Okay.
Closer to the enemies is totally fine. And then I'm going to activate the Cloak of Flies.
Okay. Why don't you read that out for the folks at home?
Okay. You can conjure a swarm of buzzing flies around you. The swarm grants you advantage on charisma intimidation checks and disadvantage on other charisma checks. In addition, any creature that starts its turn within 5 feet of you takes poison damage equal to your charisma modifier. I can dismiss the swarm with another bonus action.
Alright, go ahead and roll an intimidation check.
Okay. Let's see, where is intimidation? There we go. With advantage. A nat 20 for a total of 29.
As you do so, you pull the mace of Lyrikai, wrenching it from the shadows that leap from your arms between the cracks in your armor. And as you do so, you hold it in front of you and put your hand behind the head of the mace and watch as a swarm of flies just begins to encloak you. And as you do so, you become almost this humanoid made of these buzzing insects. And as you turn to look, you immediately fear everything around you. And you have one action before they reengage.
We're just going to attempt to run forward. Or not forward, but killing the ones in front of us is the goal.
So, the swordsman.
Yeah.
All right. That's 4-4.
Okay.
You're doing a clash, or you're doing something unique?
Just running up on them.
Alright, clash it is. Contesting.
9.
But because of your superior rank and battle experience, I will say that you won this one, and you eradicate the 4 of them, as well as the benefit of your Cloak of Flies adding to your victory in that. So you approach forward, ordering your men to attack them, Luvash, you knock two arrows, two quick shots. One, two. Two swordsmen drop. You bash a head in with your mace, and then a spellbreaker bashes one towards another spellbreaker that stabs him in the chest and kicks him off the blade. What do you do next?
We're going to attempt to quickly whirl and try to get rid of the ones that were flanking us.
All right. Emery, you have been watching everything. Your keen eyes have kept an eye on Sterark and Cornelius, Luvash and Nervek. What do you do?
How much time has passed?
Since the beginning?
Since Sterark jumped down.
About 40 seconds.
How far away is the crevice from me?
There are crevices open near
the
you.
The one that he jumped into.
The one that he jumped into?
Yes.
About 250 feet.
Okay. I'm going to quicken spell.
Okay.
Well, I'm going to make sure there's no one around me first.
You step forward away from the line.
I'm going to quicken spell Thunderstep.
Oh, okay.
I'm going to jump into the, right up to the crevice.
Okay, hold on, let me describe this. So, we watch as Emery takes three steps forward away from the line of casters, while holding the orb of Sapphire Diamond in your right hand. Lightning strikes out from it, and in a flash, you disappear. And then the air around the crevice, you watch Nervek and Luvash, you watch as the air around the crevice that Sterak jumped into vibrates violently for a moment, and another flash of light, and Emery is standing next to it.
Can I see Sterak down in the pit?
When you look into the pit, you see a hole that goes deeper.
How deep is deeper?
About 30 feet. You can see a light coming from one end of the hole, which seems to stretch out to the left and right.
I'm gonna jump down, but cast Featherfall.
You do so, and Nervek and Luvash, you watch as Emery jumps into the same hole. Nervek, what do you do?
Again, I'm gonna stick to orders. We're gonna stay here. Although I will say to Luvash, if you want to go after him, do it. We could use you here, but do what you gotta do.
No, I will stay here. Now.
All right then. And before engaging the enemy, I'm going to reach up, touch the earring. If you need me, let me know.
Of course, I reply.
Sterak, you hear them and understand them in common.
Can you hear me?
You hear Sterak's voice.
I'm going to ignore it. I don't have time to deal with this shit.
I'm gonna reply. What are you doing?
Just get down here, I'll explain.
We're gonna...
Back to the combat. What do you do?
Before you'd gone back to Emery, I'd said that we were gonna attack the ones flanking us.
So the other four shield bearers.
Mm-hmm.
Alrighty. How do you want to go about doing that?
Well, let's see. I'm going to lead the charge because of that Cloak of Flies damage, with the rest of them trailing behind me and Luvash again firing at them.
All right. Go ahead and throw plus four.
Okay. Total is 11.
You managed to take out two of them.
Good stuff.
But you get wounded in the process and take 20 points of damage.
Okay.
So you charge forward, bashing your mace into the side of one of the shields, the flies swarming over it and destroying it immediately, moving and swirling around and smashing him in the side of the head, slamming him onto the ground, followed by two quick shots, one in the torso, one right in the forehead on the target that you just knocked prone, Luvash, at your back. The two shield breakers rush forward. One, two, one, two, with elegant and quick swift strikes, takes out another one. But in the process, you get stabbed in the side by one of the swords of another one of the shield breakers. Some of the other shield breakers on the sides, shield bearers on the side of the wood elves are losing the fight around you. The high elves are overpowering them, and two more shield breakers join your side. What do you do?
There's still two of the shield bearers of the wood elven side, yeah?
Immediately in front of you, yes. There are about 100 more in the line of the combat.
We'll take out the two and then press our advantage and move forward.
Roll plus six.
You betcha. 11.
You dispatch them easily. What's your next move?
We're gonna attempt to move forward with the rest of the spellbreakers.
So are you gonna rally? You have one action before the next bout.
Yeah, we'll rally.
Alright. Go ahead and roll plus charisma.
Okay. That is a total of 17.
You rally more to your cause, and you actually realize that there were a few spellbreakers that are, spellblades that were still alive after the just volley of arrows that flew in your direction. You gain plus two spellblades, plus one spellbreaker.
Very good. And then with that, again, we'll charge.
And you charge forward. It's at this point that you were originally intended as ordered to jump into the pit. The ground in the tunnel around you, Cornelius, Sterark, and Emery, begins to shake vigorously. Roll plus squad, Ervac.
Just to clarify, my squad was... I gained three in that last rally, yeah?
Yes.
That's a 12.
12? You watch as the ground shakes and rips and tears asunder, and both you, Luvash, and two of your one spellbreaker, one spellblade, are able to keep yourselves out of falling down the pits of the earthquake tremors that have opened the earth beneath you. The rest of your squad, not as fortunate. What do? You're back down to four.
What's it looking like around us? How close are the nearest enemies?
Everybody else is locked in combat. You are the one anomaly in the battlefield. You can either help your allies or continue to press forward.
We'll help a group that is outnumbered by just a few. One where it looks like we could turn the tide. But right. Obviously close, so if there isn't anything like that.
Roll plus squad.
Nat 20 for a total of 24.
You find a group of two spellbreakers who are outnumbered 2-4, and you ambush them from behind while they're locked in combat, about to deal the finishing blow to both of these spellbreakers, and two quick shots from Luvash to the back of the head, one bash to the back of the head, and then one splattering the cranium against the ground from your mace, and the others dispatched by your spellblade. Add plus two. To squad back to the tunnels. What are you doing?
Shot at me?
Emery, Sterak, and Cornelius.
I'm gonna go after them. Or whoever's Sterak down there that I know of.
We're not running. We're
I'm going, I don't know where you are.
You're face to face with them.
Yeah. Sterak bolted and jumped in. I followed, basically about to demand what's going on, and then Emery's here, so...
I'm gonna try and talk to Emery, just spewing a whole bunch of words incoherently. Just, you're alive, you're well, oh,
point
I've got
of
so much...
order.
Point of order.
Aloud or over the earring?
Aloud at first.
He doesn't understand you.
Exactly what I was going to say. Then I'm going to touch the earring and say, I'm glad to see you.
You weren't speaking common.
It's this mark they had put on us to speak their tongue.
Why are you down here?
The king on the wood elven side gave me Kalos' seat. There's a way to bring him back.
That's literally right. Are you sure about this?
Definitely. Oh. Also,
I don't believe that seed will bring back Kalos. Or if it does, that's not all it does.
I know. Here. You have one of these too, I can assume, then, right? And what I'm gonna show him the bell.
Oh, shit.
Also, there's no...
What is going on? Third wheel alert.
You have one?
I'm not gonna touch the bell directly because of what Kalimvor had told me, like, because that would invoke his power.
No, it's your amulet. The pendant that you wear
good.
Of your wife's picture.
Good. I thought that was that, but I was just double checking.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I'm gonna show him the bell.
And Emery, you see a bell that looks exactly like your silver one, but banded in blue and gold.
Where did you get that?
There's a lot to explain. Not enough time.
What do you mean, not enough time?
And it's at that moment that you hear a voice from behind. Both you and Cornelius. Speaking in a tongue that all of you can understand.
Yeah, I see what you mean.
Friends. She has sent me to be your guide. Please, follow me and all your questions will be answered. And you turn and you see a figure draped in whitish, almost very, very, very light green robes. Very pale skin with eyes shining bright green like emeralds, pupilless.
Does she look familiar?
It is a male.
Look familiar.
No. You've never seen this person in your life. In fact, they don't even look entirely human. But that is what they closely resemble.
Would I know what race they were?
No, you wouldn't, actually.
Real quick. I heard all this over the earring, yeah?
Yes, you did.
I'm gonna turn to Lubash and... say, Lubash, I don't know what's going on, but I need you to get the hell down there.
Don't die.
Same to you.
I guess I'll try to make my way down.
And Lubash, you go sprinting towards the same hole. Now, back to the battle. You're down one. What do you do?
Mm-hmm. We're gonna... How are the other High Elves doing? Is the battle still looking to be in our favor in this area?
It's very evenly matched.
I'll help a group that is near to me. Again.
Alright. Roll plus squad.
Nat 20 for a total of 25.
You find a group of 4 versus 4. And it looks like they're already winning. They're cornering them and pushing them together. And you just come up and channel all of your gifted power through the mace and slam it down. And in a in an explosion of this darkish energy, licking out like flames of shadow, it encompasses the wood elves and they all drop to the ground. Add plus 4 to squad. What do you do next? You have a round before the next combat.
Are these all
spellbreakers?
All spellbreakers? Okay. Now I'm working with a total of 9. We'll form up in a sort of semicircle. Not very curved, but not a straight line, and we'll press forward.
And you press forward. And you watch as the ground begins to shake once again, but not in the same way that the earthquakes came before. Not the same types of tremors. And just before you're able to realize it, gargantuan roots fly out of the ground. And as you watch the line of druids that you are marching towards, you see that all of them have their arms up in unison, and this almost river of green magic and energy is flowing from hand to hand for these druids as they simultaneously cast this spell.
Can
roll plus half your squad.
Okay. Is there any way we can attempt to use the spellbreaker shields?
They are way too far away. They're out of range.
So half the squad, rounded up or down?
Down.
Okay. That is a total of 23. Unnatural.
All right. You only lose one spellbreaker.
Okay.
As they all form a circle around you and deploy their domes, one drops from below, one drops from above, and it forms this dome that protects your entire squadron. And as it drops and you look around the battlefield, you see that the rest of the spellbreakers that were on the battlefield were not as lucky. You see hundreds of high elves impaled by these roots hanging from them, about 10 feet in the air, blood dripping down the wood. Your squadron and a few other soldiers are all that is left of the High Elven front lines.
And what are the Wood Elven front lines looking like?
They're looking like they just noticed that you're the only people nearby.
Okay.
About 40 or so are headed in your direction.
How many of you can make us fly?
They all look at each other, and they all shake their heads no. They're... Sir, we're just spellbreakers. We're not wizards.
That's all right. Let's see here. Got a
General,
toolbox.
You need to get back to them. And they charge back towards the High Elven lines and are attempting to make a break in the converging forces on you.
Mm-hmm.
Do you follow?
Yeah.
So you watch as they run with their shields out in front of them, forming a almost circle around you in this moving mass of metal. You watch as many of them get struck either by root flying out of the ground or sword coming into the side, losing 1, 2, 3 spellbreakers, and they continue to run, they continue to charge, and just as you break past their line and you fly out of the front lines of the battlefield, you watch as all of them stop and they form a line between you and the enemy. What do you do?
How close are any of the casters or archers?
About 100 feet.
100 feet. I'm going to tell them to run for the archers.
They march forward.
And it's looking like, what was it, about 8 against 40, you said?
Yeah.
Hmm. Well, I'm gonna stay where I'm at and just start chucking Eldritch Blasts.
Alright.
As quick as I can, just at any of the approaching enemies.
Go ahead and roll plus squad.
Okay. That is a total of 12.
I don't think I need to roll.
Yeah, no.
That's plus 40. You watch as they all begin to converge. The Spellbreakers hold their line, and one Eldritch Blast, two, three, flying out of the head of the mace. One down, two, three, four. The Spellbreakers take down another three on their own before all of them are cut down. What do you do?
I'm going to go ahead, turn around, and I'm going to Misty Step as far away as possible.
So we watch as Nervek watches the Spellbreakers go down. Kind of shake your head. And as you turn your body, turning back around, you vaporize into black mist and then reappear another 60 feet away, back towards your allies. Show's all about you right now. What's the next step?
So is this a mix of casters and archers?
Yes. The spell bows and the spell flingers.
Spell bows, knock and draw, spell flingers. How many of you know fire spells? Anything fire related.
They don't work.
I know. Alright. How many are there?
There's still about 400, 200 of each that haven't chained, they haven't broken position from where you were at the beginning. And as you approach with Misty Step, another array of arrows goes out and blankets the battlefield, annihilating their forces with a natural 20 plus squad.
Good stuff.
The remaining 33 drop. That were shield bearers.
Alright. Once the enemies approach the front line, or whatever's left of it, I'm gonna need 25 of you to chuck whatever kind of fire spell you got.
And as you're talking, you hear this screech permeate the air. Something that you were not anticipating. Something that you had not seen before in the previous direct conflict, as the sun is gone. And you see about 150 of these winged creatures descend from the sky, from the trees behind the wood elves. Make a nature check. All of these figures are donned in green steel armor, with a leader at point, decorated with this same green steel armor, with ivy running and dancing like hair along the back, carved into the metal. What's the total on that nature check?
Oh, that total is a 13.
You recognize these creatures. They're griffins, and those are griffin riders.
I'm gonna shout, scratch the fire magic, throw whatever you got at them.
And as the griffins begin to descend down towards the remaining forces, you watch as half of these wizards begin to conjure something, and the rest of them just fire magic missiles, knocking out about 40 of the griffin riders just out of the sky. But the rest of them descend with their long pole arms and just decimate the ranks. And just as they begin to make contact, you look up towards your leader, Siatrian, who has been laying gently on this almost pagoda that has been carried by magic. And he's decorated in gold and purple and silver armor. And he stands up and pulls a sword from his side. And just in a sweeping arc across the air, every single other Griffin Rider is assaulted by lightning bolts flying from the sky, knocking out about 80 of them as they just plummet to the ground. What do you do?
How many of them are left?
Griffins or your allies?
Griffins.
Well, that was 80 and 30, so about 40 are left.
Okay. Are any of their ground forces approaching?
Yes.
About how many?
Another line of 400.
Alright. And how far is that 400?
About 300 feet away.
Okay. I'm gonna sort of address a group around, I'd say 20 to 25 of the casters, and say, when that group there hits 50 feet, I need you to chuck whatever fire spells you got. The wards, these woods will block some of it, most of it, but after that, I got a friend to call. So, do that for me, would you, fellas?
Make a persuasion check. With advantage because of your rank.
Oh, that was just a regular check. I'll add my charisma mod and stuff. So I did a regular one, let's see. 14 plus 5, that's a 19.
With advantage?
Yeah, the highest one was a 19.
Alright, we'll get back to that back in the tunnels. What do you do? This figure has appeared behind you.
She told us to follow her and she'd explain everything. But he, sorry, sounded like a woman.
He had a very effeminate voice for a reason.
I'll start walking in the direction of the figure and keep moving that way, I suppose.
You walk about 20 feet before you hear... Actually, were you trying to be stealthy or loud about it, Luvash? You're muted.
I wasn't trying particularly either way.
You just tried to get down the hole safely without harming yourselves, because it's a pretty big drop. Okay. So you hear a as you turn around, and from the hole you see Luvash descend down, leaping from side of the wall to side of the wall, side of the wall, and then touching down once again as a cloud of dust flies out from him. What do you do?
So Starek is approaching the figure. We've got Emery and Luvash just landing in.
Well, Emery was already there. The both of them were having a conversation.
Well, Emery's there, and then Luvash landed in.
Yes.
I hope you know what you're doing, Starark. And I'll turn to the figure. Is this an escape, or can we end this war?
There is no guarantee. But she has told me that you are here on a quest, and that we were to help you.
I'll nod.
I have two people I need to protect up there. So I really hope you know what you're doing, Starark.
So
I'll step towards the figure.
You can do so. Emery, what do you do?
Explain yourself. I think the people who are you? What is? Why are you down here?
You're asking the figure?
Yeah.
Answers will come in due time. For now, you may know me as a humble servant of Our Lady Illdreneth.
And who is that?
She is the birth mother.
Of what?
Everything.
And it begins to walk.
Sterok, explain.
Yeah, the light.
I was told a tale.
Of?
This Illdreneth of... which he speaked of. Spoke of.
I just have a question real quick. They're using this earring. Is it telepathic, or is Sterok actually talking out loud?
It's telepathic. That's the only reason why it works.
So I have no idea what's going on.
You don't. They're just staring at each other lovingly.
I am angry, I am confused, and I don't know what's going on.
Oh, I thought we were earring walking and talking.
Still looking at each other. Because I will.
Here I am demanding answers and making, trying to make sure you know what you're doing, and you're just ignoring me, basically. I'm not very happy.
Yes. Valsadroth told me the story of Krianos, who was the Archdruid of Illdreneth. There's a lot more you need to know, but all of this will be explained. Don't worry.
Explain it now.
There's not a lot I can explain, honestly.
Explain what you must.
All you really need to know right now is this is one way we can get Kalos back. And that's all I want right now.
Is that worth doing?
We are two bearers of hope. These bells, I can only assume, are to stop whatever is going to come out of the seed, as well as Kalos. Or at least, that's what I can imagine. I'm sure this is worth it. And with that, I'll fall silent.
I don't believe you.
Luvash, what do you do?
I mean, I don't really understand anything that's going on, because obviously I can't hear anything.
How does Nervek react to hearing this information?
I'm gonna chime in. Look, Amory, I don't know what the hell this business about the seed is, but I could really use some help up here. So I don't know what's going on down there. But it's not looking great up here, I can tell you that.
I'll chime in. Then get down here. This was never our fight.
This was always our fight.
Since when?
Since I got all kinds of pieces of metal shoved into my hand. If I go down there, I don't know what the hell's gonna happen. But something tells me it ain't gonna be good. I got a job to do. I got men to keep alive.
And if you die, then what?
I ain't planning on dying.
Do what you will.
Is this still all telepathic?
It is.
What do you plan to do with the seed?
What do you think?
Oh, two.
Tell me.
I'll just keep walking.
And this is just a tunnel around us then?
Yes, as you're going through, you're walking through what looks like a tunnel that was dug, what almost looks like by hand. You can tell by the sort of strange marks on the sides of the wall, and it's just barely illuminated by these bioluminescent sort of pale blue mushrooms that are growing naturally in this tunnel. And it just continues going straight forward.
I'm going to cast Expedition Retreat and run past them all.
Ahead?
Yeah, ahead.
You run past?
I'm going to yell to Luvash right before. Try to keep up.
You run past, and after running for about 120 feet, you come to a fork, left or right?
Right.
You run right. And you continue to run. Luvash, what do you do?
Do I see him turn right?
No.
Do I manage to keep up?
Sprinting, you see him turn right, but he still has a 60-foot gap between you guys.
I'll follow him.
All right. The figure turns to you, Cornelius, and with a very soft smile, eager, aren't they?
Addressing me?
Yes.
I'm going to start getting visibly more angry. Eager for what? All I know is that I've been allowed down here. I was trying to bring back Sterak of my squad, and I need to protect two others up there. And I have gotten nothing but silence. So what I need to know before I go further is, are they going to be safe? Are Merely and Shadris going to be safe?
You watch as the figure, who you cannot see the hands of, these long flowing robes kind of are held together at the hands in almost a ritualistic type way, in a very regal manner. And the figure pulls the arms apart, holds the hands up, palms facing towards the roof of the tunnel, and then says something in a language that you do not know. And then the figure speaks again. Now, they will be safe.
I'll slowly relax my shoulders and just walk ahead in silence.
Please, Cornelius. You may ask me questions that you wish to know the answers to, if it will help ease your mind.
If my lot is to be dragged along, to be led by the tail, in some twisted form of fate, then who am I to complain?
All will become clear very soon. We have been told your story by her, and what she has told us is that you each bring corruption brought by him. We will cleanse you and offer you a life anew, should you choose to accept. We are not your enemy, but there is a tapestry that is being woven as we speak that is much larger than this conflict above us. In her name, fate will unwind as it was meant to.
And with this corruption, I can see her again?
She, with whom you have been disconnected from, she will return.
And with that, we will move our eyes back over to Nervak. What do you do?
That depends. How close are the ground forces?
They're marching very slowly. They're about 130 feet away still.
Okay. And what is the range of the archer's volleys?
200. They're within range.
Okay. Archers fire upon those infantrymen there, and spellcasters focus on the griffins.
Go ahead and roll plus charisma.
Okay. That one.
They're waiting for orders from the commander, who has been ordering them this whole time.
Well, I'll start throwing Eldritch Blasts at griffins.
Okay. Go ahead and roll plus casting mod.
Okay. It's been a little bit since I've thrown like a regular
attack, yeah.
Yeah.
Shoot. In plus squad combat.
Well, I rolled a 2, and I don't off the top of my head remember what my casting mod is, but something tells me it's not going to be very high.
It's not. That's not that great. You airball Eldritch Blast.
That's okay.
A little more time passes. Then another volley of magic missiles goes out. That's a natural one. And the griffins descend and pluck about 20 or so of the casters out of the air. The archers fire off another volley in the direction of the approaching forces and eradicate them all.
Oh. Very good.
Natural, from a natural 1 to a natural 20.
Highs and lows.
It's ridiculous.
Good stuff.
What do you do?
How many griffins are remaining?
40.
All 40?
Yep.
Heck, I'll just... And there's no ground forces remaining.
Not that are immediately marching forward, no.
All right, then I'll just join in on the griffin attacking team.
All right. Go ahead and roll plus 6.
Okay. Natural 1.
Nope. In actuality, another squadron of 100 griffins are flying in to reinforce now and come down hard on your forces. Plucking out about 60, 30 and 30 of each type of infantry.
Mm-hmm.
And it's looking like you're on the losing side now.
Okay. Let's see. I'm going to attempt to get... Again, I'm going to try and persuade about 20-ish of the spellcasters to chuck a fire spell to try and...
overflow the...
Yeah. Got something different in mind than last time, which I just sent you a link to. So I guess I'll roll persuasion to see if I can get them to, yeah?
Yeah.
All right. That is a 22.
Yeah, and you do so. What are you going to tell them to wait for to do it?
Wait for the griffins to, Well, how close are the 100 that are approaching?
They'll be there within one round.
I'll have them do it now.
Okay. Which one are you going to do?
The Cambion, which I just sent you a link to its stats. And then I'll get you an image if you would like one.
Yeah, just so I can describe it for those who aren't familiar. All right. So, at your command, all of them ready, fireball.
Mm-hmm.
And they all in unison attempt to throw it out, and you watch as all the trees in the ring surrounding this open field begin to glow with a very soft yellow that begins to become denser and denser and denser until there's a moment where you watch it fade completely after removing all of the flame, and you know that that's your moment. You wrench free from your side this almost small tablet of stone, and you hold up your mace and then slam the tablet of stone to the bottom of the mace, and then almost destroy the tablet of stone against the ground in front of you, and you hear her voice. Yes, my child?
I need something with wings, and preferably a couple of them.
It is yours.
I thank you kindly.
And as the stone tablet bursts, these tendrils of blackish flame begin to spiral and twist and curl around themselves until they form into a humanoid shape with two stretching red leathery wings. Draped in scale armor with a long flowing tail, an almost tiefling-like devil appears in front of you.
I have been sent by the mistress. What is your bidding?
Kill as many of those birds as you can.
And with a single burst of wind, a single downward motion of both of the wings of this 6-foot-tall, red-skinned devil, it flies immediately upwards and begins to fling spears of flame out of its extended staff that it holds with it. And go ahead and roll plus 10.
Okay.
Natural 1.
Wow, it is not going your way.
That's all right.
It takes down 3 of these griffins before the other 100 reinforcements come. All right, back to the tunnels. Emery, you're running. You come to a crossroads.
What are my options?
Forward, left, or right.
Do they look any different?
No, they do not.
Forward.
You run forward. Luvash, you can't see Emery anymore. You come to crossroads.
I'll just shout his name. See if any chance he can hear me.
You shout out. You hear the echo go down the cave tunnel, Emery.
I yell back forward.
It takes a second, but it gets there.
Alright, then I'll follow from wherever the voice comes from.
And you go forward as instructed. Cornelius and Sterarch, you walk with the figure. The figure turns and says,
Sterarch, may I see the artifact?
Yes.
And you hold up the bell. It's still hanging around your neck. And the figure looks at it and then closes its eyes and smiles very warmly.
We have been anticipating this day for a very long time, Sterarch. I look forward to the fulfillment of my destiny.
Is there anything
chose me.
The both of you would like to ask or speak to about with this figure?
So you said that you've...
You've what?
I'm asking the figure that they've protected Mirli and Chadris.
Yes.
What of Thamor?
She has also told us of his story. And I'm sorry, but his time is out.
I see. I guess there is more to it than we realize, Sterarch.
Just look down.
Fear not for his soul. He will be with the mother soon.
Soon? When did he pass?
He has not yet passed.
And there's nothing she can do for the curse?
It is not her place.
Back to the battlefield. Nervek, what's next?
Well, I'm gonna fire as many Eldritch Blasts as I can. The Cambion is not dead, correct?
No.
Okay. Let's see. I'm gonna call out, I have no idea if it'll hear me or not, but I'm gonna call out for it to attempt to charm one of the griffins. If it, you know, if it doesn't work, not a big deal, but should have thought of that earlier.
To do what?
I'll have it charm one of the griffins.
In order to do what?
Just cause as much havoc as possible. Fly around and hit the other griffins. Stuff like that.
Okay. Well, it works. Go ahead and roll plus 12.
Can do. Let's see, that is a total of 29.
The Cambion manages to take out 5, and the Griffin in its stupor before it is taken down in the crossfire takes out another 3 as well.
Okay. Are the archers and the spellcasters still engaging, or are they just waiting for orders?
They're waiting for orders from the commander, preparing things and gathering for the next strike.
Okay. A-okay. We're thinning the horde.
What's next?
Let's see. How far is the impending group of griffins?
Oh, it's already there.
Already there?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, same as before. Just kill as many as they can before they die.
Yep. Go ahead and roll plus 6 again.
Okay. 11.
11. Takes out another 2 before it's impaled by 3 pole arms.
Okay.
And bursts into ash and disappears. And then the remaining griffins are gonna dive bomb the rest as your allies fail to beat the check and crash down, eliminating 50 of each of your infantry. It is looking bad. You see griffins descending from the sky, ripping heads from bodies with their massive beaks, tearing them asunder with their talons and their riders, impaling others with their pole arms. What do you do, General Nervek?
How many do we have left? Give or take a few?
You have about 80.
And what is our leader doing? Like our, I forget the name.
Siathrion? Or yes. The commander?
Siathrion.
He's watching.
Mm-hmm. What do you look like? Concerned at all or no?
Stoic. Relaxed, actually.
Mm-hmm. I'm not going anywhere, no. Still just firing when I can, trying not to die. I'm gonna go ahead and use, let's see, where it at? Armor of Agathys. Basically, want me to read it aloud, or?
I'm familiar.
Okay. Yeah. Gonna go ahead and do that one.
Alrighty. Now then. Back.
the tunnels. You come to another fork, Emery. You come to another fork.
There's like one where they change the
Right. I'm also going to scream back right to Luvash.
Alright. You hear a voice crawl into the back of your mind. Actually, it is left.
I'm going to stop at the intersection and wait for Luvash to come.
Alright, and you do so. Luvash, you catch up.
Yeah. Can I tell that the voice came from?
It sounded like the voice of the figure.
I'm going to explain what happened to Luvash.
Luvash heard it too.
Oh. Luvash, do you trust this voice?
Yeah, that's why I just can't see. Unless they do the slides, but I don't think they're going to do those because they said.
Luvash?
I'm sorry. Sorry, I got lost.
You hear a voice that says, go left, not right. And then Emery waits for you to catch up, and then you do catch up.
Is the voice Emery's voice?
The voice that you heard in your head was the voice of the figure, draped in white.
Do you trust this voice?
I don't know. I don't know what or who to trust anymore.
I do not trust Sterarch.
Well, why not?
He's acting strange.
Aren't we all? This is not really for us, is it? War.
What do you mean?
I mean, none of us really were made for this. We're not soldiers.
Nervek is.
Well, Nervek is not here right now, is he?
And?
I'm just talking about the people who are down here right now. Me, you, Starak, and Cornelius. We're not soldiers.
Why does that matter?
Because if we cannot trust each other right now, then who are we going to trust? Those people up there? Those who want to kill each other for... God, so many stupid reasons.
It's bigger than that. You need to understand.
Well, who do you trust right now?
Definitely not Sterarch. He's trying to, I'm guessing, plant the seed that was Kalos.
That is not what I asked you. I asked you, who do you trust?
I trust Nervek, trust the High Elves.
If you trust the High Elves, then your judgment is not as good as I once thought it was.
Is that so?
It is.
And while you're having this conversation, the three in the back do catch up.
Well, we must now go left. We are almost to our destination.
I guess I'll go left.
Before we go, I'm gonna kind of stop everyone just for a little bit, and I'm going to take out the little Kalos seed, and I'm going to say, do you know what will happen
if we plant this?
What are you going to do to this anyways?
For those who do not understand you because of the curse of the world tree, I will explain. Our leader, the Moi, is to cleanse it and return your friend to this realm. We are also meant to cleanse each of you of the corruption that he has planted within you, and offer you chance at life anew.
And how do you plan on cleansing us?
With the light that she has given to us, we will be able to accomplish this task. By the magic of the pool of Ildraneth herself, our leader will perform this ritual and return that which you have lost.
I believe that seed will taint it.
There is nothing that can stop her light from shining more brightly.
I don't believe you.
You are right in your doubts, but soon everything will fall into place.
Sterak, my master showed me 3 potential futures. They all lead to darkness. One to a void of nothingness, one to a shadowed world, and the third to a gray world.
I was told but one story. One that would plunge us also to a sort of doomsday, but we would be able to stop it. 2 shining beacons of light echoing through the darkness. And I have faith that we can stop this. Whatever is going to happen, I know we can stop it.
Why allow it to occur?
I'm sorry that I'm so selfish. And I'll keep walking forward.
I'm going to run full sprint, like, using with Expedition Retreat, and try and get reach their destination before they do.
Alright. This will be the last time that we look to the surface. Nervek, you heard that conversation. Any conversation between Sterak and Emery, you hear as well.
How far was the hole?
It's about 150 feet inside enemy lines.
Yeah?
Yeah.
How thick are the enemies?
Technically, they're all in the air right now.
I'll wait till they dive, and then I'm going to send it. If I can still use Misty Step, then I'm going to try it. If not, I'll beat feet.
You're going to have to beat feet, because I'm pretty sure you're all out of spell slots.
Mm-hmm. Unless I'm getting any more, but I don't think Lyric is being that generous today. So, yeah. I'll wait till they swoop down and I'll haul. I'm gonna put my hand to the earpiece. Well, fellas, I'm gonna try and get to you, but it ain't looking good. So, this might be our last conversation. Wish me luck.
As the griffins begin to dive, and then the spell that all of the casters have been channeling this whole time, they finally release it, and you watch as about 200 circular blue lights create two rows of 100 in front of the remaining forces, and those constructs that you had seen on your first day in the barracks were to life with the arcane magic and leap into the air and begin to combat the griffins, giving you a window of opportunity and evening the battlefield once again. And you book it.
Want me to make an athletics check or anything?
Oh yeah, definitely make an athletics check. You're sprinting for an extended amount of time.
Athletics. Total of 18.
All right. I'll tell you when you get there.
Okay.
Our eyes go back to the rest of the group, and then they shift over once again to Emery. You book it as quickly as you can, both physically and magically enhanced, until eventually you see a light at the end of this tunnel. You run almost shimmering into the end of the tunnel, obscuring anything past it. What do you do?
Keep running towards it.
You pass through the threshold?
Mm-hmm.
You pass through the threshold, and around you, you see a circular, almost dome-like room with about six on either side going around the circle. Six more of these figures draped in these white and silver robes, and standing directly in the center of this shimmering pool, in the center of the room, standing on a single foot on the very thin surface of the water, you see a figure with long, flowing, soft-tipped antlers extending from just behind the ears, going backwards, forming almost a crown. And as you cross the threshold, you hear the figure speak.
Hello. Son of Silva.
Who are you?
I am Thamwa, the leader of this circle.
I am told you intend to purify my companions and some sort of being in some sort of light.
We have been preparing for quite some time, awaiting your arrival. And now that you are here, we may begin the cleansing ritual. Soon, you all will be free of Kreanos' curse.
I believe he intends to poison your light.
We have seen what she has wished us to see. He holds no power here since he gave up the old ways.
And yet part of him is re-entering.
To be cleansed in her light. If she had not willed it, you would not be here.
I say you have roughly about 30 seconds before everybody else gets up to you.
You must trust me when I tell you. Do not cleanse that seed.
We have our divine mission, our own destiny, one that is much less significant than yours.
And what does that lead to? What is the final, what is the end of this mission?
That is not for me to tell you.
You're making a mistake.
She spoke of your doubt. Fear not, child of dragons of silver. Soon all will be well.
It's at that moment that the rest of you cross through the threshold of light and enter into this room as well.
Ah, Sterok, would you present that which needs to be cleansed?
Sterok, do not give them the seed. You must trust me.
I'm sorry, Emery.
Why?
I'll walk over and hand it.
Tell me why. What good will come from it?
Before this can continue.
And the figure washes over with a sweeping gesture. And Sterok and Cornelius, you feel very, very faint all of a sudden. And a sharp, stinging, cold pain in your dominant hand.
I'm going to look at it.
You look at it. The mark is gone.
What just happened?
I'm not sure.
And Luvash and Emery, they're speaking common.
Sterok, do not give them the seed.
This is fate. Emery, you can't outrun it.
It is foolishness. If you do, you'll doom us all.
My god spoke to me.
Your god? Which god is that?
He wants me to keep the balance of life and death.
That didn't answer my question.
Sure, he's the god of death. But I trust a god more than my friend's judgment right
and
now.
And what god did you follow before? Because I know you didn't death forever.
Protection. And where did that get me?
Where did death get you?
Look at me!
Congratulations, you have flesh.
Enough. I'll hand them the seed.
I'm gonna cast Banishment on Sterok.
That is a charisma saving throw. On...
Plus, I'm going to, see, where is it? I'm going to use Heightened Spell, which means he rolls with disadvantage.
Okay.
And I'm also going to use Bend Luck.
Okay.
Which I roll a d4 and his roll is reduced by whatever I roll.
Okay.
Alright. Let me go ahead and make a disadvantage roll.
Your roll's reduced by 2.
Okay. Natural one.
Where do you banish him to?
It's to a pocket dimension, if I'm not mistaken, because it's he's native to our plane. if that's correct, of course.
I mean, you can choose any of the number of pocket dimensions. So you do so, and now I need you to make a strength save. Well, me? I would actually need you to make 6 strength saves. Because Emery, because all of the other cloaked figures are casting Entangle on you.
Can I... Let me see. Points am I at? Trying to figure out what I can do. I'm going to activate Bend Luck, or no, not Bend Luck, Tides of Chaos, which will give me advantage.
On what?
On a roll.
You need to make 6. Are you sure you want to do that?
I can't really do much else unless I can cast a spell between that.
Well, they're casting it as you cast Banishment, so it's kind of just point of order thing.
I can't really, unless I...
You would get advantage on the first one, and then there would be 5 more. I'm just giving you the option if you want to roll for them, because it's very unlikely that you'll be able to stave off 6 entangles.
Let me see.
Just a question while this is going on.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not really sure of the effects of banishment. Is that something I can attempt to dispel?
It's a concentration spell, and it's up to a minute. But that's something that I told Fluff. I would need Cornelius to make an Arcana check.
Now or after the entangles?
Whenever.
How far am I?
It's going to take a bit, but as you jump down, the guide is waiting there for you.
Oh, cool.
I'm going to use it anyways.
Okay.
So I'll make the saving throws.
That first one isn't enough. That's why it's super unlikely, man, that you were going to be all 6. So you're entangled. You still maintain concentration on it. It's not going to, entangled isn't going to deal damage to you. But they've restrained you. And as you look around the room, you see all of the robed figures with their hands against the ground. And the roots have grown from underneath you and entirely wrapped around you, almost like a pillar of vines encapsulating your body.
I'm going to yell out to the rest of them. Don't let Sterark give them the seed.
What did you do?
We don't even know what's going on.
He'll be back very soon. We just needed time for Nervek. Or do we know Nervek's on his way?
He
said he is, right?
He said he was, but he hasn't said anything since he said, "Oh, I might die, by the way."
I needed time for Nervek to arrive.
Why?
Because that seed will be our doom. It will poison their light. Can I roll a persuasion check?
I actually have a question in relation to all this.
Uh-huh. Run around that. Say that again.
So I know what my own Deva looked like.
Uh-huh.
Are these creatures similar?
No. But I will say that they do seem angelic in nature.
Can I try to figure out exactly if these are like... Because I've kind of been on edge this entire time with this, but can I kind of try to figure out if they're more lawful or chaotic?
Make a religion check.
That thing I have a whole lot of. That's an 11.
You can tell that they're angelic in nature.
So I can reasonably deduce that they wouldn't necessarily want the destruction of the world.
Probably.
So now everyone's speaking common, right?
Yes.
I'm just going to turn to Cornelius. I can try something. I'm not sure it will work, but... I'm not sure it will work, and it will definitely hurt him. But if it does work, it would be very helpful.
And this is?
To explain it very briefly, I can use magic arrows, and they do things. One of them would be quite useful right now.
Try not to kill him, but I'm going to choose to trust these. They don't appear to be devils in disguise.
Well, I'll be honest, I'm not 100% sure what is going on. I don't understand what these creatures are or what they want.
Do you remember what the Arcfey told us? He wished us to plant the seed, if not mistaken, in a font of light, a energy source of some sort. A pool of light, perhaps.
Is the guide still here?
No, the guide went back, actually. She didn't. He didn't cross the threshold. You guys might slip me up. He didn't cross the threshold.
And the leader, is it still at the pool?
Yes, standing in the center of the pool on the water.
You must not let the seed touch the
water. Your guide offered that they would answer any questions that I had. Does that extend to you as well?
We are running out of time.
Yes, but of course. Soon.
Okay, quick question to the DM. So I have an arrow. I have banishing arrow, which allows me to banish someone to the Feywild. To a harmless location in the Feywild. Can I choose what that location is? Or would you choose it?
I would choose it.
Alright.
What's the duration on that?
It's 6 seconds.
Okay.
Oh no, sorry, 12 seconds.
Okay. Wow, that's 2 rounds in combat. That's pretty good.
Yeah.
Do you know for certain what will happen when you try to cleanse the seed?
Why, yes, of course. She has instructed us to do so. So we will.
Even gods are not infallible.
The fathers and mothers of the gods speak to us.
Enough of this.
And
can I pop. Be cleansed first?
Derek is back. Minute is up.
I will hold out my... Does he reappear in the same place?
Yes.
I'll hold out my arm in front of Sterark. I don't know what will happen, Sterark, and I know what you want. Can you hold off for just a while? We are here.
Go on.
Can I be cleansed first?
If you desire, it can be done.
Consider me a little selfish here, guys, but there's so much mistrust, so much arguing, and I've been led on for far too long. I need the only voice that I have ever known to trust.
Nervek, do you cross the threshold of the light?
Yeah, I'm gonna. And just FYI, I haven't dismissed the Cloak of Flies, and it lasts till I'm incapacitated or I dismiss it, so I'm gonna stay 5 feet away from everybody.
Okay. You're gonna keep it on?
Threshold.
Yeah, no,
I might need it. As I cross, Emery, what the hell is going on?
And you approach the pool, and the figure standing on the water says, "Step into her light."
Hell no. I don't know what the hell's going on. I'm not stepping into any light. I don't know who the hell she is. Emery, what is going on?
Do you step into the light, Cornelius?
I do.
And
amidst all the screaming.
Yes.
And the buzzing.
And the buzzing. You walk forward into the pool, and as you do so, do you happen to remember where your point of entry was for the Shade Worm?
It was the crook of my neck.
Oof.
Like my collarbone area.
That's bad. So
it got stabbed into me!
It did. So as you step forward, the figure begins to hum. This sort of angelic tune. And as they do so, the arms begin to almost move in a very mesmerizing way, and the light of the pool begins to grow in intensity, and you begin to feel the point of entry opening.
Yeah.
But not in a painful way. Almost being drawn from a needle, this very thin line of inky purple liquid is pulled forth and out of you, and is suspended in air above the pool, and in a flash of light it is vaporized to nothingness.
And I don't feel the influence inside me anymore?
No.
I will immediately kneel.
You kneel and go almost waist deep in the water.
And I just cry out for my guardian. I'm not even going to try to do it mentally.
We'll get back to that. What is everybody else doing?
I'm explaining to Nervik what's happening. Telling him, don't let Starrock put the bean in the water. In the light.
Well, alright. I wanna look over at Starrock now and, I'm gonna intimidate.
Well, Starrock, what do you do?
I didn't even notice that Nervik came in.
I'm gonna put a hand on his shoulder.
Well, there's a little bit of a distance between you, and he has time to make one action.
Oh, okay. I'm just going to walk over to him. I'm not doing anything menacing as of yet.
Quick question. How long does entanglement last?
They're chain casting it, dude. You're there for a good chunk.
They're stacking.
They're casting it one after the other after the other. That's six spell casts.
Remember, Starrock.
That's not what you said.
I had a request.
Well, the first one landed, so.
Well, you said that, yeah, but. Here, what you said.
I'll get the duration.
2 million years.
Sorry. Might as well be at this point.
Starrock, I want to apologize. I didn't know what was going on out there in the forest that day.
Well, before you got close, I wanted to say something.
I was going to say, that could be from a distance.
Okay.
Like, I could be walking and talking.
Hold on. Uno memento. Entangle. Is concentration up to a minute, so you're there for at least 6 minutes until all of them are done casting on you.
That's, I have to make a save for each one.
Sure. I mean, their entire purpose in standing there is to be a guard and keep people from not getting in the way.
Okay,
it's probably going to be with disadvantage because you're already entangled when they're going to entangle you again.
That's not how it works.
Anyway.
Magic.
Starrock has an action, and that's what matters.
I was going to say, if anything does go wrong, let us all be purified first, there's any influence, who knows what that might spell. But hold on to this. Do not purify it yet. And I'll hand it to him.
You hand the seed. You hand the seed to the person on the water?
Oh, wait. Do I have to walk in the water?
I mean, you can throw it, or...
I don't want to risk that one!
Someone is currently Ben/is being purified. Just want to point that out.
I mean, Cornelius is right in front of you.
Yes, I just want to, like, completely specify that I want us to be purified beforehand. Before that seed gets purified.
Strength save, Emery.
Six.
Actually, and now go ahead and make another one, because that would have been the first one after banishment ran out, because it happened at the same time and that was a minute. Keeping track of time is a little weird right now.
Wibbly wobbly.
It is wibbly wobbly.
Timey wimey.
Go ahead and make another strength 13. Save. 13. You're looking to hit 15 or higher. Okay, so you hand the seed to Cornelius.
What?
Because.
No. Well, I'm already.
He's currently kneeling in the water.
I'm currently.
Okay, so you're gonna walk. I need a point of order. Is very important here. What is Sterak doing?
I'm gonna hold it out, and hopefully he'll do whatever magic floaty he does and walk over here.
So you don't want to step in the pool.
Not yet.
Okay. Begins to walk
forward. So have I been pulled out yet, or can I hear everyone yelling about this? Because if that's the case, I'll just grab the seed.
Well, yeah, like, we'll get back to what you're doing. It's not going to happen immediately.
But yes, I'll open palm it. Like, okay. Very careful.
Nervek, what do you do?
Am I close enough to intimidate?
By this point, yes.
Sterak, you don't want to give him that bean. Saying it as menacingly as I can.
It's kind of difficult.
Channeling any bit of extra spooky gross flies that I can.
Okay.
Dude, that one's a grub.
I'll throw intimidation.
Okay.
With advantage because of fly.
Fly.
Spooky fly.
28.
Well.
That is a gross fly.
What do I throw against that? Or do I just get?
I think it...
I would say make a wisdom save. That's just my ruling.
Okay. The hell be...
That's mostly meant for like...
Almost, but no.
Yo, I got that 4.
Okay. You are intimidated.
I'm gonna panically, like...
You don't want to give him that bean.
Make a dexterity save.
Nineteen.
You drop the seed and barely catch it.
And I want it to be clear, I'm not harming him in any way, I'm just speaking to him.
You are a fly humanoid with Nervek's voice, that is what you are.
A fly humanoid with Nervek's voice who's not harming him.
You don't want to give him that bean.
You just don't want to give him that bean.
Wait, how do we know that's Nervek?
Fair.
If you say that in character, I'll...
No, I mean out of character. How do we know that's Nervek? I don't think I saw him before.
It's not like an all-encompassing wall of flies. It does say cloak. It doesn't really describe how thick they are, but I would assume I have some control over them.
Sure. There's a face window.
I'm going to close the open palm and kind of retract. Slowly.
It's at this point that you hear a voice.
I tire of these games.
Omnipresent. All around you. The figures in the white cloak do not react at all. And the only person who cannot hear the voice... Well, actually, Emery can't. And Cornelius can't anymore.
Wait, why would Nervek be able to?
Actually, yeah, Nervek can't either. It's just Luvash and... So I'd like both of you to make wisdom saving throws.
Oh boy. I don't like any of this.
9.
17.
Make a dex save, Nervek, to see if you get a chance to react.
Okay. Nat 1.
And that was the Nat 1 that wrote the story. You know what? Just for the ultimate Hail Mary, make a strength save to break out of the entanglement.
Okay. Let's see. What can I do?
Oh, I'm going to use Dark One's own luck.
Can you give that to other people?
No, on myself.
Oh, okay.
Well, actually, I...
Well, I mean, it's not really a conventional dex save, though. It's kind of... It's like the equivalent of a reflex save in, like, 3.5. It's just, like, to see if you get a reaction against this.
Okay, so no Dark One's own luck?
No, sorry.
Okay.
Can I react to this?
You can't hear or see.
Oh, I slipped into it.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
Okay, I'm thinking so... I messed up.
So what was the strength 20. Save?
20. It unnatural was... 20.
Unnatural 20?
Yep.
You break free. And you watch as a purple haze of mist encompasses Sterak's eyes and Luvash's eyes, and you get a reaction to do something before Sterak drops the seed.
Okay, let me see.
I just said to wait! Why didn't anyone listen?
I was trying to get him to wait. Flies and stuff.
I tried to ask real nicely.
I'm going to... How much of a reaction do I have?
A reaction.
So one action?
No, a reaction. Something that you can do when it's not your turn.
Ah. My action surge.
RT.
How about would a bonus action work or no?
Well, it depends on what it is.
To cast like a spell, like a.
Yo, just fireball me at this point.
Like, could I activate what's it called? Quicken spell, get a bonus. Bonus action. And then cast banishment again. Because I have the spell slots for it.
Yeah, but you can't quicken spell it up to a reaction. So. Do you have anything you can use as a reaction?
Hellish Rebuke.
Well, you damage something that damaged you, I think, is how that works.
Yeah. Well, no, I can use that as an attack, I think, but as a reaction, I don't know.
Well,
yeah, no, that would have to be an action.
So you don't have anything that you can do as a reaction?
Not
go for the grapple!
Yeah, I'm gonna go. Grapples. Honestly, yeah, I'm gonna go for the grapple if I can, if that's not an action.
I'll let you cast banishment again,
But okay. You have to roll on the magic surge table.
That's fine. That's fine. Yeah. So quicken spell, that's 2 sorcery points, I think.
Okay. I just put the book down too, back with the rest of my setup. Give me a second. I haven't had the book this entire time. And usually I have it right next to me. Charisma save with advantage. Sterarch, because you're being influenced by an outside force.
With advantage?
Yes, with advantage.
Whoa.
Is he still intimidated to not drop the bean?
Well, shit. He's charmed now.
Okay. 23. But, Nick, you were saying wait?
No, never mind.
Yeah, 23.
Random magic table?
Yeah, random magic table. I'm trying to flip over.
Summon another unicorn.
I have it open.
Just roll on it.
1d100.
Oh, baby.
29. You teleport up to 60 feet to an unoccupied space of your choice that you can see.
Oh!
Guys, how far away from him, from the thing is he?
Only like 20. He's only 20 feet away from you.
No, how far away is he from the water?
He's right next to the water's edge.
I'm teleporting
in between us.
Yeah, in between him and the water, and I'm gonna try and die for the bean.
Okay, make a dex save the same way I had him do it. The ultimate Hail Mary.
This is it.
Out here on some Ocean's 11 type of shit.
Dex do save it. Or dex check?
Yeah, either or.
No. That was the nat one that wrote the story.
So
it was just delayed.
You try and cast banishment. He shrugs it off. The purple haze over the eyes flashes and dispels the spell. And then you feel a wild magic surge. You clutch the sapphire diamond, and then you focus the wild magic surge to teleport, and you dive, and it bounces off of your fingertips and into the water. And then the voice on the water says, "Oh. Oh dear. That is unfortunate." And as soon as the figure finishes saying that, the whole thing turns from an opaque white to an inky black. In an instant. And then you hear a voice. Once again. Luvash and Sterarch, you are no longer charmed. Oh, it is about time. Hello, brothers. And you see at the center of the water, the figure that was standing there begins to step back slowly in palpable fear. But then you see a bubbling mass at the center of it on the otherwise still water, and emerging forward, you see a bud. Almost like the bud of a flower. And you begin to see it grow slowly in size. What do you guys do?
I dismiss the flies.
Okay.
I'm in my own little world.
Still in the water.
I am awestruck at this point.
Unless I get some sort of message to tell me to move.
Can I cast banishment again?
On what?
The seed.
The seed is no longer there. It has to be a creature.
Can I actually, better yet, I'll cast blight.
idiot. You don't know what it is yet, and you're already throwing things at it.
It's a plant. I cast Blight.
What if that's Kalos?
It's a plant. I cast Blight.
You're gonna kill Kalos again.
It I'm has to be a creature.
Hmm?
It has to be a creature.
No, Blight works on plants. Magical plants. A plant or magic creature.
Or magical plant.
Yes, but it's not considered a creature. That's the premise of the spell.
If you target a plant, creature, or magical plant, that's a magical plant. If you target a non-magical plant that isn't a creature, such as a tree.
I didn't keep doing. Okay.
I'm going to sacrifice a 5th level spell slot to get 5 sorcery points. And then I'm going to activate heightened spell. And I'm also going to use Ben Luck.
Can't you use that only once?
Oh, no, not Ben Luck, sorry. Not using Ben Luck. Actually, no. Yeah, I can. I can only use Tides of Chaos once. I can use Ben Luck as many times as I want. As long as I've got sorcery points for it.
Okay. Alright, roll that d4.
Yep. 1. So minus you roll with disadvantage. You have to be a DC 17.
Well, I can already tell you that's a 4. Okay. Throw damage, I guess.
It's a plant.
I'm not familiar with how Blight works. Will you explain?
No idea.
I'm going to it right now.
Okay. It does 88 necrotic damage, I think.
It just deals maximum damage to it.
Yeah, so it does 88 necro damage. Which is 60.
But you did a level 5, so it's 98.
No, it's not. I cast level 4. I sacrificed a 5th level spell slot to get sorcery points.
Okay.
64
damage.
Wait, 64?
Yeah, 8 times 8.
Oh, I thought it's 6d4.
Sorry.
Nintendo 64!
How much health does Kalos have? Does anybody remember?
I can tell you.
Yeah, if you would be so kind.
He has.
Did we throw health for him?
No, we do have his health. He has 60 health.
Well, hold on. Here's the thing. Did we throw health for where he's supposed to be at now?
No.
How many? What's your constitution modifier?
My con mod is +2.
Okay, how many levels did you guys go up between arcs?
We're at 10.
What level was Caliber? 3?
Yeah. I believe 3.
Then okay, he has at least 6 more, so he has 2 health regardless.
Just the roller coaster of emotions.
You idiot, man!
Hold on, we have to keep going through this. So, as I was saying, you watch as Emery is holding the sapphire diamond in his hand, and light is just reflecting inside.
The diamond doesn't that give me a bonus damage? To
only
turn
only on spells that have attack rolls involved.
Oh, okay.
And you watch as the black energy inside begins to bounce and refract against the many crystalline edges inside and then fly in a cloud outwards towards the bud. And you watch as a majority of it withers and dies, but a small portion of it begins to grow outward more and more, continuing slower now, but continually growing in size until eventually it stretches over the pool entirely. And as the last portion of the bulb unfurls open, you begin to see the figure of a humanoid creature beginning to unfurl and stretch outwards. Dark brown hair with emerald green eyes. Standing at 2'1", you watch as Kalos rises to his feet, looking like at any moment he could fall back down as a majority of his skin has become pockmarked and necrotically damaged, I guess, suppose. And as you watch Kalos's eyes slowly drift open, you hear the sound of slow applause. And you watch as all of the shadow in the pool begins to rise up slowly in small globules until they all coalesce to a single point above Kalos's head, extending out into a humanoid shape. One arm, another, a leg, another. A head adorned with antlers stretching outwards, and almost as if eyes opening slowly, two beads of white light grow in size. And you hear a voice. Hello, once again, my friends. You have done well. Suspended with both arms out in a very deity-like fashion, you see the antlered man suspended there. And as per our deal, your friend is returned back to you. Kalos, what are your first words?
Well, before that, did I see any of that going down? Like, did I see Emery?
Oh, you saw everything from the seed's perspective.
I'm going to look to Starark, and I'm going to weakly, because as you said, I'm close to death, I guess, or close to faint.
Fading consciousness.
Yeah. I'm just going to say thank you so much, friend. With a weak smile. And I'm going to look to Emery, kind of betrayed, and just say, but you, how could you? You tried to kill me. Just kind of surveying, you know, being back alive right now. That's all I'm going to say for now.
And you feel a force at your back as you're standing in the open petals of this rose, almost pushing you off of the pool. And Krianos lifts his arms on either side as light begins to pour outwards in a pillar of darkness. And it touches the roof and explodes to the ground, ascending upwards. And that's what we'll pick up next time. From everybody here at D&D Universe, I'd like to thank you all for watching episode 7 of season 2 of Draenora's Song of Steel, and we'll see you in episode 8, The Calm.